unprecedented times, exposure, quarantine. These are the words that have become so familiar in our vocabulary now as we are in this time of COVID-19. But friends, even though we are dealing with this as a community here in East Texas, my hope and prayer is that there'll be a new excitement and a new energy unleashed today as the core community is introduced to our new pastor, John Wayne McMahon. John Wayne and Lauren come to us from Kingwood United Methodist Church in Kingwood, Texas, where they've served for 5 years. John Wayne is a graduate of Sam Houston State University and also went on then to Asbury Theological Seminary and is continuing his studies currently at Union Theological Seminary, where he'll earn his doctorate soon. Friends, how exciting it is to get to know this young man, this wonderful leader, this gifted teacher and passionate preacher of the gospel, who has at his very heart the idea of making disciples to change the world for Jesus Christ. I know you'll be blessed as he brings his message today, and I wanted to give you a formal introduction of one of our new pastors here that we're very excited about, who will take core ministry to another level through his gifted teaching and leadership. I want to let you know that his wife, Lauren, joins him. They've been married now for 6 years, and they have two wonderful children, Luke, who's 2 years of age, and Riley, who is 9 months of age. Welcome again to this broadcast. Let this be an introduction of John Wayne to the community here at Marvin Church, and especially to our core worshipers. We're glad that you're tuning in today. God bless you as John Wayne now brings the message to us.
Thank you, Dr. Baker, both in his work and discernment and wisdom and speaking to my family and bringing me to this space. I also wanted to update you. Dr. Baker had to record that at home because he's under quarantine right now as he takes the utmost precaution after being around someone that tested positive for COVID. He's healthy. He still remains healthy. Going through those precautions for this community to keep everyone safe. But I'm thankful for that introduction. It is good to be with you, friends. It is good to be finally with you. It has been a while preparing for this moment. My first time to be an itinerant pastor doing this major transition, and I describe it like a Band-Aid that's just slowly being ripped off. It's just really hard and difficult in many different ways. You add in everything that's going on top of that, and it's been interesting. But we've been praying for you. Lauren and I have been praying for you in many different ways and waiting eagerly to meet you and to be in this space. And I'm still eagerly waiting to meet you and be able to look around the room and see those faces that are here. Marvin and Core have a reputation that precedes you, and it's a good reputation around the conference. And so I'm just thankful for the opportunity to follow my friend David and his leadership here, but also to be with you. Let me give you some general introduction so we're at least a little more than strangers as we begin this journey together. Dr. Baker helped that a little bit, but I want to just introduce you to my family. I wish they could come up on stage today and meet you, but we'll do that soon enough. And know that my intention during this current sermon series of a season of hope is to introduce myself and my family to you more deeply as we go throughout July. And so we'll do that in different ways. But to begin with, let me just tell you about my name, John Wayne. Yes, it's true. Okay. This is not made up. My middle name's Wayne. Sometimes people will call my wife Mrs. Wayne. That's my middle name. She loves it when she gets that. But John Wayne McMahon, it came from the urban legend is that I continue to tell is my dad had a terrible bet in college that whoever had the first son out of his group of friends would have to name that son Miriam, because Miriam is John Wayne's real name, if you know that. And I was the first son, and my dad, in his stubborn ways, followed through on this bet. And my mom said, there is no way that our firstborn is going to go by Mary for the rest of his life. And so they met in the middle with John Wayne, and that's how we landed. I embraced that. Things could have been different and harder for me in grade school, right? That would have been a lot different. And so I've heard all of the impersonations. I've heard all the jokes. You can share them with me and I will give you one of those laughs like it's the first time I've ever heard it. But I wanted to share that with you up front. My friends and family, and I hope you will feel comfortable calling me John Wayne. Just know that I extend that to all of those that know me. If I ever say John, it's because I'm worried that I'm only going to talk to you for like 30 seconds and I don't want to have to explain the whole name thing again, right? But here's the introduction for you to be able to call me John Wayne. I want you to see my family, Lauren, Luke, and Riley. We've been married for 6 years, as Dr. Baker shared, and we have two beautiful children, Luke and Riley. Luke is a rugrat, as you can see. This is the best picture to kind of encapsulate him as well. And Riley is the prettiest thing. She definitely started to develop into Lauren's looks even early on. And so those are our beautiful children. Lauren and I are from Bryan College Station. We are both big Aggie fans. I hope to share that with you. But we didn't finish at A&M. Lauren was led to licensed veterinary technician school in Houston. She's an LVT. She's at home with the kids right now. But if there's any vets in the community, there may be a day where she's ready to jump into that workforce. She's incredible at what she does, both with the kiddos as mom, but it's impressive to see her at work in her element as an LVT. I graduated from Sam Houston State in 2012. If you have any late high school kids or college kids, come see me about what not to do in college. I did the extended 7 or 8 year plan as God's calling developed in my life. I thought I was going to finish from business school and get my MBA and become some rich person before Jesus radically changed my life and some of my goals and my purpose. I served in student ministry for several years at FUMC Bryan, and that's where I stole Lauren's heart forever. Well, that's where I began asking her out while she ignored me for like a year, but eventually she came around. She tells a different story than I do, but I'm the one with the microphone in here today. But she's definitely my better half. I can't wait for you to meet her. Graduated from Asbury Theological Seminary in 2016 with a master's in divinity, ordained in 2019 and back into seminary. The only thing I'll correct from Dr. Baker is he said I go to Union Theological Seminary. I'm going to United Theological Seminary. Those are two different seminaries. The one I'm going to is the United Methodist Seminary in Dayton, Ohio, where I'm pursuing a doctorate in ministry. I'll share more about that journey later on. We served before here in Kingwood. That's the Northeast Houston area for 5.5 years, amazing years of ministry. We just loved our time there. And we had a tough time wrestling with this move and being here. When we went to Kingwood, it was an unexpected time for us to go to Kingwood. And on the surface, we felt like there was no reason for us to do this. But when we visited the community, God gave us a peace. This is where we're supposed to be. And I share that with you because God has done the same thing in bringing us to Marvin and to Tyler. We weren't looking to uproot and do all of the things that we just did, but God has been so gracious in his development of all of this. And so we're excited to be with you. All right, that's enough for now. I'll share some more with you about my faith journey today and more about our family in the coming weeks. Now for this sermon series. I know that you've been in the wilderness, as I think every North American church decided to do a wilderness series with all that's going on. There is two series that I think everybody did this year. It was the 2020 vision, seeing clearly in 2020, right? I'm blaming the pastors that preached that series for all that we're enduring right now in 2020 because they couldn't stay away from that. So it's their fault. But anyways, I don't know if y'all did that. Love you, David, if you did, but it's all good. But all of us were in this wilderness. I preached through a wilderness series, and I just felt like as I was talking to the team and getting to know everybody here, we're tired of being in the wilderness, though we still have some of those themes and things that we're facing as we go back to online. But we really felt like God was leading us to talk about hope. How does hope shape us and form us? How does hope send us out even in hardship and difficulty? And so we landed on this series called A Season of Hope. And I'll introduce parts of my story, but we're also gonna preach about the hope of Jesus Christ. So this is where we're going for the next few weeks. Today, we're gonna talk about the living hope. And so we're gonna look at 1 Peter chapter 2, starting in verse 3. If you have your Bibles or your smart devices, you might be streaming on your smart devices, but if you have your Bibles with you, I just wanna encourage you to turn to that as we read God's word. 1 Peter chapter 1, starting in verse 3. Hear the word of the Lord. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all of this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy for you receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Let us pray together. God, we give you thanks again for your presence with us and at home, online, as we gather together today. I pray that you would add your blessing to the reading of this scripture. Where we are empty, would you fill us? Where we are weak, would you strengthen us? Where we are wrong, would you correct us? And would you send us out once more? God, I pray for myself that you would speak through me or in spite of me, but may it be your message that's delivered. We love you and trust you. It's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Hope is an interesting idea. It is something that in many ways we have lost its deep meaning, its deep flavor, much like the word love. Like in 1 second, I could say, I love my wife, Lauren. And then a few minutes later, I could say, I love fajitas, right? Now, fajitas are God's manna from heaven. Like they are a grace unto themselves. But if I love fajitas in the same way that I love Lauren, there's something wrong there, right? There needs to be a difference there. And we've kind of lost the same word when we think about hope. Hope is the same way. We have hope for deep personal things in our life. And at the same time, we have hope for the kind of silly things in life. And it confuses our mind about what hope really is. It kind of changes it. It kind of cheapens it for us. Like, I hope the Dallas Cowboys will win again. I hope that they'll rise again to the top. Now, I pray moving from Houston up here to Smith County, I've got a little more brothers and sisters that are with me in this Cowboy train. That's a whole nother side. It's hard to be in Houston as a Cowboys fan. Anyways, the hope that I have in the Dallas Cowboys better be different than the hope that I have in Jesus Christ, right? Otherwise, we kind of confuse those two ideas. Think about it. What is hope to you? What is this hope that you think about? And what are the things that you assign hope to in your life? We know it's some kind of emotion. It's some kind of feeling or belief. It's something that pulls us and shapes us in different ways. We know it's positive, right? Usually hope is this positive aspect that brings us forward. It's something good in the future that is not yet realized. Scripture is going to talk about it in different ways. We desire it. We anticipate it. And friends, what we are anticipating shapes who we are. What we are holding out for, what we are thinking about, what we are meditating on, what we are shaping our life around, even if it is not yet achieved, it shapes us in the present. This is important for Christian hope. In our text today, Peter is going to talk about the living hope of the gospel. And I want you to see it again. I want you to see this in the opening section. Peter delivers the goods. He's going to base the rest of the letter on these first verses that we have shared together. I want you to see it again in verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of salvation is ready to be revealed in the last time. And friends, I want you to see there's some guarantees right here in the text that Peter is laying out about hope. The first one is a future hope, which is the final resurrection. That even as things seem to deteriorate and look broken and the chaos is around us, we see that every time we turn on the news, right? We see chaos around us. We know that there's a future hope of resurrection where he will restore all things, where he will make all things new once again. And we always look forward to that final day when Christ will return and he will set things right. That's what Peter's saying. The first thing you need to know, that even when everything else kind of goes to the garbage, we know this future hope that can never be taken away. And you may not wake up in the morning and think in these terms, but every time you weep or cringe when you look at the news or you see something else going on in the world, we know that things are not the way they're supposed to be. That there's supposed to be something different. And we have this future hope where we know that he will make all things new again. Let me give you an illustration of that. In college, there was a time when TiVo, where you could pause TV, had finally come about, and we were taking advantage of that with the national championship. We invited a bunch of friends over, and we were watching the game, and I guess we ran out of chips, or we ran out of drinks. I don't know what drink it was, depending on what year in my journey. I'll share parts of that later, but we ran out of something, and we paused the game, right? And we told whoever was gonna go and get refuel everything that we needed, that we would pause, we would wait for them to get back. We wouldn't start the game without them, and we would continue on later in the afternoon. Don't talk to anyone. Don't look at anything. Turn the radio off when you drive over there. Don't check social media, that kind of thing, right? And so we finally get back together. A couple hours later, we had, you know, we were eating and hanging out, and we press play again. And there was another friend who was in charge of the remote at this point, and there's a live button on remotes now. And my friend accidentally pressed live. And we went to the end of a national championship where they're dropping the balloons, and we know who won without watching the game. But here's why that illustration works for us, because even though we lost some of the thrill of watching the game, we knew who was going to win. And so it changed how we watched it. So even if the winning team, the team we knew was gonna win, was down to their last down, or they were running out of time, or whatever it was, we still had this peace, you could call it, that we knew how things were gonna play out. That's the future hope of resurrection, that things may look rough, that we may be down to our last timeout and our last 10 yards to go, that we may be all but hopeless, it seems, but we always have this future hope of the resurrection. Specifically as Christians, we have this inheritance, as Peter says, in the thing that we look forward to. An inheritance is usually the other way around. Someone dies and we inherit what they have. This is different. Jesus lived so that we might have our inheritance even now. That's why Peter says that we'll be protected by God's power as we wait, that we'll be shielded, as the text put it. Paul puts it this way in 2 Corinthians. Therefore, do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. This is what Paul's saying. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. That's the future hope of resurrection. Paul says, church, do not lose heart. Even in the struggle, fix your eyes on what is unseen. This will be your anchor. This will be your truth. This will be what gives you hope as you walk forward in obedience. Let me give you another example of this. Over the 5 years that I was in ministry in Kingwood, we had lots of trauma and lots of events that took place in just a couple years' time. We had some major pastoral transitions, the retirement of a senior pastor, and then as a new pastor came in to a large church, that's a hard transition already. And as the senior pastor came in during that season, about 30 days after he gets there, Harvey happens. And we had almost 200 families in our church alone flood. And we had to respond to what was going on. Kingwood was just in rough shape. And during Harvey and during these other seasons of life, later on, about 3 or 4 months later, that new senior pastor died of a heart attack, tragically. And in this season, we had to learn the power of hope. We had to be formed in this way. One of those specific stories came out of Harvey, where my friend was flooded and she had to be rescued from the second story of her house because that's how big the water was. We have some pictures of what Kingwood looked like during this time. Kingwood is right there in that region. And the city streets were filled with water. There's another picture of boats down our main street in Kingwood as boat rescues took over. And my friend was someone that needed to be rescued by boat with neighborhoods that took on 20 feet of water or more. And as she was taken away from her house, then by a high water truck later on so that she could get to a place on dry land, she shared this story. She was sitting next to someone else that was also rescued. And this amazing conversation took place where my friend, her name's Melinda, was trying to encourage the other person that was with them in this high water truck. And as they got to the houses that didn't flood, the other person on the truck turned to Melinda and said, "These people are lucky because they didn't flood." And I'll never forget these words that Melinda shared with her. She said, "Yeah, they're fortunate, but this is what gives me hope, because there's people who didn't flood and they can help us rebuild. See, there's two different perspectives here in this text. The first one here from Melinda is that hope is a perspective that is important, that matters. The other person just sees the people that have not faced the difficulty, but hope is a way of seeing what is unseen, knowing the promise that is before us, that is right here for us. Secondly, I want you to hear this, church, as sin and death and evil and flooding and brokenness and suffering is all around us, there is one who didn't flood. There is one who defeated death and evil and sin, who will help us rebuild, and his name is Jesus. And he is our living hope. Peter says, I want you to set your eyes on him. However, it's not just some future reality that we look forward to. It is something that reaches back from the future and into the present and changes us now. The second thing that Peter talks about is being born again. We have hope even now. See, friends, there is future hope of resurrection, but there is hope that is already at work in us. Again, look at verse 3. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. John Wesley, founder of the Methodist movement, would say those that have been born again, they have these marks in their life, that they have faith, hope, and love. They have faith, this obedient acting, this belief to know that if I've been born again, I can walk another step down this road because he who has promised is trustworthy. They have hope, as Wesley puts it, because hope is that thing that helps us to face full on the anxiety that comes in this world, that we could face fear that comes in this world, that we have this thing, even if it's unseen, that grabs our heart, that protects us and shields us, that helps us to move forward. And Wesley says, for those that are born again, they have love, radical love, to love one another, even when it's hard, even when it's difficult, and to love on a whole new way. This is the promise for us, to have faith, hope, and love. This is what living hope is supposed to look like. Let me share a part of my story. I grew up in a good, loving home. We were in church very early on. By middle school, I was into competitive soccer and traveling, which can quickly make church be kind of a when it's convenient kind of thing. And so church became eventually this thing that I went to for the girls or for the cool mission trips, right? The summer trips that were going on. And I had this marginal faith. And if I'm honest, I think at times our family had this marginal faith and participation in church. And at this point of me leaning into this and understanding what God's doing, as I look back, I can see these ways that my marginal faith created this facade of religion. And when things crumbled in my life, my faith and my purpose crumbled like a house of cards. I went off to college and partied pretty hard. Almost got kicked out of school as I was accused of cheating on a midterm. That's a whole nother story. I actually did a lot of things, but I didn't cheat. But that was one of the things that I almost got kicked out of school for. So I was in Memphis, Tennessee, and I was sent home. But up to this time, I was largely successful with minimal effort in a lot of things. I was the kid that could do homework in the morning and just get through with things. I wouldn't have to try that hard. And I was arrogant and I was prideful. I was built up on this story of John Wayne, and I thought I could do no wrong in the world. And when I came back home from school after almost getting kicked out, I remember that I felt a little bit lost. Like I was realizing these things that I believed in didn't really mean very much. And then one night I had too much to drink at a party. I was waiting tables. If any of you have ever worked in a restaurant, that crew is a wild crew. And I went out and I had too much to drink one night, and I tried to drive home after sleeping for a couple hours, but I still was well over the legal limit. And my truck, I remember, broke down. I had this old beater truck, and it broke down about two blocks from my apartment. But there I sat with keys in my truck, waiting for a tow truck, essentially, and the police came to check on me to see if I was doing okay. And I was out of it. I just didn't know what was going on kind of thing. And long story short, I spent two nights in jail. I went in on a Saturday night, which is a bad time to be able to see the judge and work through things. So here I am feeling like I could do no wrong. And I spent a couple of nights in the worst place for me to be. And it was so hard for me to understand what I had done and how I was going to face this moving forward. And so I was a mess by this point. I get out of jail, I'm ashamed, I'm trying to figure out where to move forward, and this faith that I had had built on the marginal religious kind of participation when it suits me was not helping me move forward at all. I could barely pay for school, much less this very expensive DWI that I just got, and I didn't know what I was gonna do. And I remember there's this part of probation where I'm on house arrest, where you can go to work and you can go to school. I'm wearing the ankle monitor and everything, and I'm waiting tables, and in walks somebody from the church, a former youth pastor of mine, and they sat in my section, and they began to ask me questions. And I danced around the questions as long as I could. I didn't really want to share all of that part with a former youth pastor. And I think that she could tell things were a little bit convoluted, that there was something under the surface. And she looked at me and said, "John Wayne, I want you to come serve at the church with me. I want you to come work around students." And that's when I was like, "Okay, listen, I got an ankle monitor. You don't want me around your students. Like, that is not a good decision." And she just would not take no for an answer. Maybe not a great ministry model to repeat for those that are in ministry in the room, but she would not take no for an answer. And she said, "I want you to come." And what I experienced in that season was the living hope of the church being breathed over someone who was so lost. And that church in that moment became the church for me for the first time. And where I was messed up and broken, and where I was a little bit hard on the edges, where I was still trying to figure out what it looks like to be someone who can contribute in the world, they loved me with so much grace that I began to know Jesus through them. This is this season where Living Hope was introduced to my life. And as I began to serve, something changed. I started to think about others more than myself. I started to feel loved again, and to know that I could love others. I started to see purpose for my life. The gospel of Jesus Christ started to take root in my heart. Now, some people have these saved on dates. They have this crazy story, like they were, you know, almost dead to addiction, and then on this day, a light came and shined in their lives and everything was changed. I don't have one of those. I like to say that I was slow cooked over many years, right? That God was just kind of like adding to the story a little bit. And at some point I woke up, I'm like, I think I'm a Christian. I don't know. I think that I know Jesus, but he was adding up over these years, even from my childhood, these things in my life. But there did come a moment where I knew that Jesus not only died for the sins of the world, but he died specifically for me. That he died so that I could be whole, that I could know this hope. That he died so that I could be a part of the family and could know and could have and could live into this inheritance. I was born again into a living hope. And maybe you are like me, you don't know when that date was, but you woke up and you're like, I think I'm on this journey. I think I'm walking in this way where faith, hope, and love is now taking root of your heart. I had this sense of purpose. And things were not perfect, but there was something different at work in me now. Jesus was not just taking me away from partying and all that nonsense. That was what was on the surface of the deeper reality that I didn't know who I was. I didn't know what I was created to be. I didn't know what God was calling me to be. And in that season, he became my living hope. That hope has built a marriage that can withstand hardship, God willing and his grace continuing, which I'll share part of that hardship next week. That hope has carried me through school and debt and failure and family difficulty. That hope has helped me to lead in crisis. That hope has helped me to give up sin and walk away from the things in my life that are not important. That hope has been the only consistent, inextinguishable flame that is in my life. And that living hope is available for all of us today. That living hope is going to be what we offer every single week in core worship. Every time we take this stage, whether it's online, whether it's with a packed house, whether it's on Christmas, or whether it's in the middle of July, we are going to always proclaim this living hope because nothing else matters. Even the last couple of years, I realized that God was helping me, that he was calling me to be a part of helping people that maybe need to be saved out of church. Because I grew up in the church. Maybe some of you have been a part of the church forever. And I just pray that you would know that this living hope is not just like an insurance policy. It's not just something to make you feel better on sad days. The power of the gospel is that you are not only free from sin, you're not only forgiven from sin, but you're set free from it. That you're not only brought into the family and called a child, but God works in our life to make us live as children. That you are lost in one sense and now you are found. That this inheritance is a power that works out in our lives so that we may go deep into all that he is. And finally, I want you to know that this hope can never be taken away. This hope is imperishable. Friends, there are things in this life like my hope in the Cowboys that can be taken away, usually about 3 weeks into the season, right? Maybe sooner. Someone's gonna get arrested, someone's gonna hold out for a contract, and I'm gonna have to wait till next year. But this hope, this inheritance that we have in Jesus Christ, it can never be taken away. It cannot be taken away by floods. It cannot be taken away by COVID-19. It cannot be taken away by brokenness in your home. It cannot be taken away by the strife that you find, the difficulty at work, or whatever you're facing with your kid or the kid that you wish would come back home. Whatever you're facing, it cannot be taken away. It cannot be taken away because our living hope is imperishable. It has a currency that backs it. And this future hope is the present hope that we stand in. And that's why Peter says it never spoils or fades. As I close, I just want to share a few thoughts for you today. So long I grew up playing church. I grew up going through the motions. And in different seasons of following Jesus, I can find myself right back there. But I'm here to tell you, and I hope that this is the banner that we fly over this season of ministry together, that the living hope has no replacement. The living hope is for us today, tomorrow, and in the days to come. The living hope, Jesus Christ, is all that matters as we learn as a community to give ourselves to him. See, friends, everything else is counterfeit. It has nothing of power behind it. It's like the counterfeit bill that may look like something to put your hope in on the outside, but it can't actually buy things. It's lacking the currency that is behind it. And listen, the things that we pursue in this life, our career or money or success or even the good relationships in our life, are no replacement for the living hope of Jesus Christ. And in this season, we must know this as a community, because when we look at the news cycle, we see unverifiable truth. We don't know what to believe and who to listen to. We see racial divide across our country. We see a political polarization that is just unmatched. We see things happening that are spinning out of control. And in this season, we must cling tightly to the living hope, Jesus Christ. Your restoration and healing is there. Anything else is a counterfeit. It may look like it carries something with it, but it'll be found wanting at the end. Once the right light is shined on it, or once the right circumstances come together, you'll see that that hope is actually fleeting and fake. Friends, it won't take long for the right circumstances to show you the places where you've been putting your hope and other things that are counterfeit. They have no currency behind them. My hope today and in this season is that this would be the banner that we fly at Marvin United Methodist Church. That this would be the banner that we fly over the space, that we would begin to pray that this band, that this ministry team, that this tech team, that the greeters and the ushers and those that'll be a part when we welcome people in here, that those that will sit in these seats, maybe for the 100th time or maybe for the first time, that they would know that we have been captured by a living hope that can never be taken away. May it be so in my life. May it be so in yours. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, let us pray. God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for this message that you've brought us today, that your living hope is forever, that this promise is here for all of those that are watching online, whether they're a longtime member of CORE or a longtime member of Marvin, whether there's someone that's joining in for the first time, I pray that hope would reach into their house, that hope would strengthen the places where they're feeling weak today, that you would give us a declaration today, that you would help us to declare it to the world that our hope is in you and nothing can take it away. We love you and trust you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.